the chairman of this meeting, Comrade P. Madhu, and comrades and friends. I thank the Basapunya Vigyana Kendram for giving me this opportunity to speak about the current political situation in our country. As you all know, the 17th Lok Sabha elections have resulted in a big victory for the Bharatiya Janata Party. And the Modi government has come back to power with an increased majority in the Lok Sabha. This represents a right-wing consolidation of Indian politics. 5 years earlier, in 2014, when the Modi government came into office for the first time, we had stated that this is the beginning of a right-wing offensive in Indian politics. And that right-wing offensive has culminated 5 years later in a consolidation of the right-wing forces in our country. We have to understand, first of all, what will be the consequences of this right-wing consolidation. First of all, this represents a more aggressive pursuit of the Hindutva ideology and forces. The RSS and the BJP have the long-term goal of a majoritarian rule in India, that is a Hindu Rashtra. And in pursuit of that goal, this victory in the Lok Sabha and the second stint in office of the Modi government will unleash the Hindutva forces to pursue their goal with renewed vigor and determination. We are already seeing in the last 2 months since the Modi government has come to power that in different parts of the country, on the streets, people are coming out demanding that those who do not shout Jai Shri Ram, they have no place in our country. In Jharkhand, a 23-year-old man, Tabriz Ansari, was beaten to death because he was a Muslim. And he was forced to shout Jai Shri Ram while he was being brutally assaulted. Such instances are taking place in other parts of the country too. This represents the communalization of our society, the attempt to deepen the communal polarization, and a naked attempt to consolidate what they consider is the Hindu community behind the slogan of establishing a Hindu Rashtra. Already videos are circulating in the social media with inflammatory slogans that those who do not shout Jai Shri Ram should go to the Kabristan, to the graveyard, and similar such videos. Only 2 days ago, our party filed an FIR against these videos, and we wrote to the Home Minister, but the Home Minister is Amit Shah, demanding that criminal action cases be filed against those who are circulating these videos. They are such nakedly inflammatory videos that I read in the newspaper today after arriving in Vijayawada that 4 people have been arrested in Uttar Pradesh for producing these videos and circulating it. At the government level, the efforts to infiltrate and place key RSS personnel in various constitutional bodies, as vice chancellors of central universities, of key positions in the bureaucracy, judiciary and other wings of the state have been speeded up in the last 2 months. So there will be a concerted effort to subvert the constitution from within and to see that the Hindutva ideas and the Hindutva goals are furthered by utilizing the state machinery and the instruments of the constitution. The second feature of this second term of the Modi government will be a more aggressive pursuit of the neoliberal policies which are favored by the big business and international finance capital. Already in the last 2 months, the government has announced various policies, just like the privatization in various sectors of the economy. In the union budget which was passed recently in parliament, ₹1,05,000 crores of disinvestment of public sector enterprise shares has been announced. No sector is going to be spared. Even the Indian Railways, they are going to privatize it piecemeal. Within the next 2 months, you will see that they are going to give private companies certain lines to be where private trains can be operated. So step by step, privatization of the public sector, privatization of the basic services which are essential for our citizens, this is going to be pushed through. This is the agenda of the big business houses of our country, of international finance capital and multinational corporations, who had fully backed and supported the Bharatiya Janata Party and Narendra Modi in these elections. They are going to be paid back for this support, paid back for the tremendous funding, the funds that they gave to the BJP for the elections. So this is the payback time. The government is going to do what is required from them for their agenda. This is a government which has been promoting crony capitalism. That is, they have got some favorite capitalists and big business houses who have got all the advantages, who have been given all the resources. And we have seen in the last 5 years of the Modi government how two of the biggest business houses have profited the most from Modi rule. Between the years 2014 and 2018, India's richest man, Mukesh Ambani, had doubled his wealth in the period of this 4 years, 2014 to 18. That is, from $23 billion to $55 billion. He has doubled his wealth in these 4 years of Modi government. The second capitalist who has benefited the most is Gautam Adani, whose wealth has increased 4 times in the period of these 5 years. That is, from $2.6 billion to $11.9 billion. So you can see that this is a government, this is a ruling party which has the backing of practically the entire big bourgeoisie, the big capitalists of our country. Alongside this pampering of the big business and foreign capital, you will find that more attacks on the livelihood of the working people, on the rights of the most oppressed sections, whether they are Dalits, Adivasis, backward classes, are on the agenda. Just now, the government proposes to amend the Indian Forest Act, a result of which will be that Adivasis who were given rights under the Forest Rights Act to get pattas in the forest area, now they will be nullified and the forest department can evict them from the forest areas. The amendments are just going to be placed before parliament. So we can expect policies which are going to favor the richest sections and policies which will attack the economically and socially most exploited sections. The third feature of this second stint of Modi government will be an increased authoritarianism. Already we have seen how they have tried to impose an authoritarian rule in our country in the first term of the Modi government. That drive for authoritarianism will be stepped up. Authoritarianism would mean attacks on democracy, on democratic rights, on the right to dissent, on the right to oppose, on the right of the freedom of expression. All this is coming under attack. The labor laws of our country are going to be drastically changed. There are 17 labor laws or legislations which are there at present. The government has decided to scrap all these legislations and bring only 4 labor codes. And under these 4 labor codes, the basic rights of the workers, which have been gained over decades of struggle, the rights of trade union to form out trade unions and to function trade unions, they are going to be severely curtailed. This attack is coming already. 2 of those code legislations are before parliament. One example I can give you. There is an act called the Sales Promotion Employees Protection Act. This covers all the medical representatives, etc. That has been scrapped, that act. And in the new code or act, sales promotion employees are not brought within the purview of the protection of industrial relations and trade unions. So they will lose all the rights which they have fought for and got, that is medical representatives and sales representatives. So there is such a direct attack on the rights of the working class and the employees. The parliament is also now discussing certain amendments to draconian laws like the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act and the National Intelligence Agency Act. The move is to make these laws more draconian. They are already draconian. For instance, in the amendments to the UAPA Act, it is proposed now you can declare some organizations as terrorist organizations. Now they say we will decide who are individually terrorists, people are terrorists. And this will not be decided by a court of law. This will be decided by the Home Ministry. You can be declared a terrorist. After you are declared a terrorist, you will be listed in the list of people who are terrorists. Then your properties can be attached. You can be put in jail without trial for 6 months. All the basic rights of a citizen can be deprived. But the onus of proving you are not a terrorist is on you, not on the government. So this sort of laws. The second aspect is of authoritarianism, is that federal rights, rights of the states are going to be completely curtailed. In the same UAPA amendment, it says the National Intelligence Agency, which is a central police organization, they can come to any state, seize property and attach it. The present law says they must get prior approval of the state police chief before doing so. The amendment says no need to get the approval of the state police. They can come directly and seize the property. So such draconian laws are being pushed in the parliament. These draconian laws will be used to suppress anybody who dissents, who opposes the Hindutva forces. Already they are using the term urban nakshals. Amit Shah has again repeated in parliament that these laws will deal with urban nakshals. That means already you have seen there are people in jail People like Sudha Bhardwaj, a lawyer who has been fighting for labor rights for the last 35 years. He has been declared an urban nakshat. And there are various other intellectuals and writers who are already in jail under the UAPA. They cannot get bail because they are charged with having links with the Maoists. Authoritarianism means also establishing one party dominance and one party rule, that they do not want to tolerate the opposition at all. And for that, apart from coercive measures that they are taking against opposition party leaders, the other method is to induce defections from these parties. And we are seeing large-scale defections from the Congress party and other opposition parties to the BJP. They are being bought over. The BJP is flush with funds, funds provided by the corporates and big business. They have the system of electoral bonds where anonymously they can donate to the ruling party. Neither has the donor to declare where he has given the money, neither has the party to declare whom they have got it from. It's very convenient. More than 5,000 crores was collected by the BJP during the elections through electoral bonds. So they are now purchasing MLAs and MPs. You have seen in Karnataka how 17 people were purchased, whereby the Congress JDS government has fallen. You have seen how in Goa, overnight, bulk of the Congress party in the Goa legislature has crossed over to the BJP. You have seen in other places also. You have seen how the TDP 4 Raj Sabha MPs have crossed over to the BJP, because the anti-defection law says two-thirds crossover, then it becomes a merger. It is not defection. So wholesale defection is now being organized by the BJP. So the BJP is resorting to the most unethical, immoral tactics in encouraging defections. But at the same time, we must go deeper and see why this sort of phenomenon is happening in India today. In our country, under neoliberal capitalism, more and more politics is becoming a business. More and more capitalists and businessmen have invaded the political system. From the parliament down to the panchayat, you will find more and more elected representatives are actually businessmen, real estate contractors, liquor barons, all sorts of other businesses. They are the people now getting elected from the non-left parties. If you look at the Congress MLAs who have defected to the BJP in Karnataka, I've got a list of them. Most of them are actually businessmen. They are real estate people, they are contractors, they are liquor barons, they are mine owners. One of them, MTB Nagaraj, is the richest MLA in the Karnataka Assembly. During the assembly election, he has declared his assets to be worth 1,050 crores. Now, he is one of them who has defected. Because for them, politics is a business. They have no affiliation to any ideology or party's policy or program. They will go anywhere as long as it suits their business interests. Who are these four TDP MPs? You all know them very well. They are from Andhra Pradesh. Who is Y.S. Chaudhary, who is Ramesh? All of them are primarily businessmen. Politics is only in aid of their capitalist enterprises and business. So there's no question of any ideology and loyalty for these people. Now, this is the type of politics which has become prevalent under neoliberal capitalism, except for the left parties. Whether it's the Congress or most of the regional parties, they are suffering now the consequences of having business people and capitalists as their leaders, as their members of parliament, as their MLAs, they are now being paying the price for that, because the BJP can easily lure such people, use the CBI, use the income tax department, use the enforcement directorate and threaten them, and they are vulnerable and they cross over. The man who has crossed over, who is the leader of the Congress, opposition in the assembly of Goa, he has now crossed over and become a minister in the BJP government. Everybody in Goa knows he runs illegal gambling casinos. A large number of casinos, which are gambling casinos. So the BJP could easily cash him. So now he's become deputy chief minister of the BJP government. So this is the type of politics which has vitiated, Democracy has been vitiated by the power of money and business and politics getting combined. So we are now facing, with this right-wing consolidation, challenges on these three major areas: the Hindutva communal offensive, the neoliberal aggressive policies, and the growing authoritarianism, which poses a danger to our democracy and to our constitutional values. So we have to face this. The question is, how do we fight this challenges and overcome and advance? This is the key question before us today. Unfortunately, many of the secular opposition parties do not see how to fight this consolidated attack, except by trying to see how to face the next elections, how to fight the BJP and the RSS in the next elections. Our contention is that should come later. First thing is, we cannot fight the BJP and RSS only in with electoral tactics, because the BJP and the RSS have got the tremendous money power backed by the corporates and foreign capital. They have the RSS, which is a strong organization which has a network all over the country, which is spreading the communal ideology and the disruptive ideology, which is seeking to create communal polarization. And third, we have seen the character of this party, which wants to suppress democracy and subvert the constitution by using strong arm methods and tactics. So we cannot just concentrate on merely electoral tactics to fight this force. The first area of our fight and our struggle must be the ideological sphere. The RSS has an ideology which it is taking in a big way to all sections of the people throughout society. They are working through their various frontal organizations and outfits to spread this Hindutva ideology, which then provides the basis for the BJP's political influence. So unless we fight this ideologically, we will not be able to break or counter their offensive and then advance. We have to defend the secular ideal and the secular values embedded in our constitution. Secularism does not mean anti-religion. A person can be deeply religious. A person can have faith in their own religion, but also be secular. These are not two contradictory things. Because in a country like ours, a society like ours, secularism means not privileging one religion, people of one faith over others. That's all it means, basically. And the state will not interfere or utilize religion in state matters. This has to be pursued. So we have to take this message to the people, that those who call themselves representatives of the Hindus and say that all Hindus must combine together because there is a threat posed by the other, which is the Muslim, or the threat posed by Pakistan, Hindus must get together. But these Hindus are not one homogeneous block. There are Hindus who are big capitalists, the Hindus who are workers, the Hindus who are poor peasants, there are Hindus who are Dalits, there are Hindus who are Adivasis, there are Hindus who are women. You do not want to give them any equal status within your Hindu order. But then you talk about Hindu consolidation, a pan-Hindu unity to fight against the threats to the Hindus. So all this must be countered effectively. We have to also ensure that this defense of secularism is not abandoned. We should not follow or do what the Congress party did during these Lok Sabha elections and the previous period. They decided that we must show that we are good Hindus, we are better Hindus than the BJP. And Rahul Gandhi was visiting every temple, wherever, whichever constituency he went to campaign. Even in the constituency in Kerala, where he filed his nomination, before that he went to the temple in that Wayanad constituency. But that will not help, because it only strengthens the BJP. BJP says, look, now they are following what we are doing. And in Madhya Pradesh, in Rajasthan, where they form governments, the Congress party has assured they will do better cow protection than the BJP. We will have gaushalas in every panchayat. We shall institute Vedic studies, state board, government board of Vedic studies, all slogans which they think will help them to counter the BJP. But that is the wrong way. The right way is to defend secularism firmly. Secularism means it is in the interest of all religions and all communities, whether they are the majority or the minority. And a democracy in India can survive only with secularism. Without secularism, there will be no democracy also in India. This we must be able to effectively take among the people. The second area where we have to concentrate is the widespread attacks which are going to come on the rights of the working people, the right to organize, the right to protest against the burden of the economic policies which are now being imposed on the people. We have to build the widest unity of different sections of the people. I said about the attack on the labor laws. This will require the widest unity of all trade unions who are already now coming together to fight against these amendments to the labor laws. So such wide unity for defending the rights of the workers, of the peasants, of the agricultural workers and all other toiling sections must be established. Similarly, the Hindutva forces are inimical to the values of social justice. They are inherently anti-Dalit, anti-women, anti-Adivasi, because they still believe in the Varnashrama Dharma. So the struggle at the social sphere, the struggle against social oppression of different communities and the struggle for social justice must also be conducted vigorously. Finally, there has to be a broad mobilization, building the broadest platforms to defend democracy and democratic rights. Every day we are seeing attacks on those who dissent. People are put in bars by filing cases of sedition because they have written some post criticizing some government policy. People are being lynched because they have a different way of life, a different culture. So all attacks on democracy and the rights of citizens must be resisted. Yes, day before yesterday in Kerala, one of those people who wrote a letter to the Prime Minister, 49 well-known prominent intellectuals, writers, filmmakers, they had written a letter to the Prime Minister saying, what is happening in our country, in the name of Sri Ram, you are lynching people or killing people. This is doing disrespect to Lord Ram. You should put a stop to this immediately. Immediately, all those 49 people are being targeted by the BJP and the RSS. One of them from Kerala, is an internationally known filmmaker called Adur Gopalakrishnan. So the BJP leader there put a sent a, issued a statement saying Adur Gopalakrishnan, if he cannot tolerate Jai Shri Ram, he should go to the moon. He should go to Sri Harikota and take a rocket and go to the moon. He cannot live in India. Against that statement, in Kerala, yesterday, hundreds of protests, meetings were held by cultural bodies, writers' organization, by panchayat organizations, and the Prime Chief Minister himself came on television and said, we will not allow this sort of threats and against important people, prominent people in our state. So this sort of resistance must be built up against any attack on dissent or giving attack on the freedom of expression. So we have to build up our ideological struggle. We have to step up our ideological struggle against the Hindutva communal ideology and forces. We have to build the widest unity of the working people to fight back the attacks on their livelihood and rights by this BJP government. And we have to build the broadest mobilization of all democratic sections, all progressive sections who want to see that authoritarianism is not imposed and democracy in our country is protected. If we engage ourselves in such struggles, multifaceted struggles, we will be able to build up the resources and mobilize the people which will be able to help us to counter this reactionary right-wing consolidation which has taken place, and we will be able to break through and make an advance for the left and democratic forces in our country. This is the perspective with which we should engage our full resources and work. Go to the people in such a big way that we will be able to break through this right-wing consolidation and pave the way for the advance of the left and democratic forces in our country, which alone can save our country from this dark forces of Hindutva. Thank you very much. Let EVMs require credibility and verification. And that is why finally the entire opposition had taken a stand before the Lok Sabha election that you have the VVPAT, that is the paper record tray. When you press the EVM machine or button, you can see on a screen who you voted for, and that paper ballot goes into a ballot box. We have been saying tally 50% of the EVM units with the VVPAT unit to ensure that then we can see if there is any manipulation or any discrepancy. Unfortunately, the Election Commission didn't agree. Then the matter went to Supreme Court. The Supreme Court only increased. In every assembly constituency, one EVM unit was being matched with one VVPAT. They increased it to 5 in every assembly constituency. So in a parliament constituency, if there are 7 assembly constituencies, 35 units would be tallied. We said this is not sufficient. Now still there are many questions about EVM. Some are saying that it can be manipulated. I don't think we can say there was large-scale manipulation of EVMs in this election. That will be a wrong political understanding or diagnosis. We will miss the real issues. Because I live in the north. I have lived in Delhi for now 45 years. I could see the wave building up in this election for Modi. After the Pulwama and Balakot aerial strike, they utilized that fully. And in places like Rajasthan, in Himachal, in Uttarakhand, we could see the big swing in their favor. But yes, we must ensure that EVMs cannot be manipulated. We are conducting a technical study. We have got a group of technical experts to look into the matter. Other opposition parties are also undertaking that study. And after that, we'll come to some conclusion about what should be done. Right now, our stand is EVM, use of EVM needs to be cross-checked and verified
through this method of VVPAT counting. But that has not been accepted, but we will continue to press for that. In the meantime, we will also look into the technical aspects about whether EVMs can be hacked or whether the chips used in the EVM are foolproof, etc., etc. But there is a wider question which I couldn't touch in this my speech, which is the need for electoral reforms. Much more problematic for us is the use of big money power in this, in elections, especially in South India. In Karnataka, in Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, we know huge amounts of money are utilized. So electoral reforms are required. Now candidates have expenditure limit, parties have no expenditure limit. The BJP can spend 25,000 crores as a party. There is no limit to that. Only the candidates have 75 lakh or whatever limit. So parties' expenditure limit must be there. Secondly, there has to be some form of state funding. Many countries have that. So various electoral reforms are required. Otherwise, we cannot stop the vitiation and perversion of our electoral system. So this is a matter which we have to take up in a big way, the need for electoral reforms. Our party, for example, also wants proportional representation introduced with a list system. That is, some constituencies will be there, territorial based, but there should also be a party list, and the percentage of votes you poll nationally, according to that percentage, some seats you will be able to get. Otherwise, you have cases where a party gets 25%, 20%, 25% in state and won't get a single MP from that state. That's happening in all of many places. So that is why we have a set of electoral reforms. Many parties also have discussed this. We have to push for these basic electoral reforms. What is the situation in West Bengal, Kerala and Tripura? What situation? If I start explaining, it will take a long time. But I presume the questioner wants to know in context of the parliament election, performance of the left in the Kerala, West Bengal and Tripura elections. Now, I will very briefly say, in West Bengal for 7 years, we have faced violence and terror instituted by the Trinamool government and the party. Tripura has started facing that for the last 1 year after the BJP won the assembly election. Just now the panchayat elections are being held in Tripura. Today is 27th. Do you know that 86% of the seats in the panchayat elections have been won uncontested by the BJP? 86%. What do they do now? They have taken a leaf out of Mamata Banerjee's book. Nobody is allowed to file nomination, so that there is no election. They will prevent the opposition from going to the block development office to file a nomination for the Gram Panchayat and the block samiti. They will beat you, they will threaten you, they will go to the houses, threaten the families. They will even kill you if you file your nomination. And those who succeed in filing nomination, then they will not let them live in peace till they withdraw the nomination. That happened in Bengal in the panchayat election. Now it's happened in Tripura in the panchayat election. So you can understand what type of elections are conducted in these two states. Only difference this time was, in West Bengal, there was so much anger against the Mamata Banerjee government. The anti-incumbency factor was high. That was utilized by the BJP. We could not utilize it. Because in many places, Mamata Banerjee and the Trinamool had ensured that our party organization can't work even. Their target has been not BJP and the RSS, their target has always been the CPIM and the left. After this election, now she is understanding. Till then she was helping BJP and RSS. You grow, that will be good. Polarization will be between us, you and BJP and TMC, but now the BJP is after her blood. They will not stop. They will now try to capture the assembly. So now in many areas where CPM was not even allowed to enter, because the TMC got defeated there, we were able to enter. Already, out of the hundreds of party offices which are captured by the TMC, slowly some of these offices are now being taken back by us. So change is coming in Bengal, but it will take some more time. Tripura, unfortunately, is a very small state, 35 lakh population. Everybody knows everyone. The RSS and the BJP, which was not a force before, why have they become strong? Because the entire Congress party joined the BJP before the last assembly election. And they are continuing with this reign of terror. It will take us some more time. Some more sacrifices have to be made. Some more suffering will have to be faced by our cadres before the turn will come. Because now BJP has won the election in the centre, they will intensify the attacks against us. But we have to keep fighting. As far as Kerala is concerned, it was not a serious setback. It was electoral setback, yes. We lost 5.1% of the vote, but our mass base is intact. In Kerala, Lok Sabha election, always there's a divergence between the Lok Sabha election and the assembly election. A section of people who vote for the left Democratic Front in the assembly, they vote for the Congress in the Lok Sabha because they think at the national level, we are not a factor. We said defeat Modi and BJP. They said you are not a force at the All India level. Only Congress can fight the BJP. That was the illusion they had because they thought Congress will do well. And Rahul Gandhi went and contested in Wayanad. They said here is the future Prime Minister going to be from Kerala. That swung some votes in their favour. That is how it helped them to sweep the election. But this is a temporary phenomenon. After that, bipoles to panchayats have taken place. The left Democratic Front has won half those seats which they had earlier, they maintained. Various elections to students' unions have taken place. The left has swept those elections. So there will be no major setback in Kerala. But Bengal and Kerala, Tripura, we have to continue to fight against both these forces in Bengal, the BJP and the Trinamool, because Trinamool is directly oppressing us. People have moved away from us and voted for BJP saying you are not able to protect us from Trinamool atrocities, tyranny of Trinamool. So we are going to vote for BJP because maybe they can protect us because they have got central government. So it will take some time for us to break this polarization between TMC and BJP. So in very brief, I have given you the position in these three states.
And that question, at present, when we are weak and people are not in a position to listen us, how can we take anti-BJP struggle to the people?
What does anti-BJP struggle mean? If your rights are being attacked, if your livelihood is being attacked, the issues which are there before the people, as a result of the BJP rule and its policies, we have to take up those issues. Once we are able to draw them into movements and struggles and bring them into a broader mobilization on these issues, then we will be able to convince them about the BJP and the RSS. Without that, it can't be. Just by saying they are communal, making propaganda, it can't be done. We have to concretely take up what I said. Attacks on democracy, communal attacks, economic policy attacks, all these social issues, the attacks, all these things we have to take up amongst the people. We must patiently work among the people. That's why I said, as far as the left is concerned, we are not looking for electoral success now. First, we have to win the people. We have to get the support of the people. After that comes the electoral success. Without that, you expect shortcuts and somehow you will be able to fight the BJP or win elections. That's not going to happen. You have to get the people. For that, you have to be with the people. We have to take up their struggles. We must be able to identify with all their things. And unless we do that, you will not be able to make any headway with your political agenda. To counter BJP attacks, we need our agenda, our program. not anti-BJP agenda. As far as the left is concerned, we already have an alternative set of policies, an alternative which covers all aspects. I was talking in terms of, first, before we can even project this alternative, we must be able to establish links with the people and get on various issues, draw them in, and then be able to, after that, tell them this is the alternative. Without that experience of drawing them into struggle and movements against these policies, only then can we tell them these are the alternative issues or policies.
Foreign currency bonds are proposed to be issued in the recent budget. What is your opinion? I will add a little more. In 2015, National Investment in Infrastructure Fund was also established in India with a paltry funds, which we call it a sovereign wealth fund. It is not actively engaged. Moreover, earlier, East India Company was supposed to be the owner of India. India, if you go look into the Times, you are calling it as India Incorporation Company, India Incorporation, but not India Republic. And foreign companies, I mean, Goldman Sachs in particular, is treating India as India Corporation. Parliamentarians can be purchased, even so that they can have the control. I can have the resolution in their favor and dominating the country,
yes,
and owning.
Even foreign the currency bonds, main thing is this budget has announced that government of India will use sovereign funds for commercial borrowing, government borrowings, using floating bonds. This is a totally bad idea. It will be harmful for our national sovereignty. It will give further leverage for finance capital, international finance capital, to gain vantage positions in our economy and then utilize that to dictate to the government of India policies. That will be the result. So we should not accept. In fact, already within the establishment, there is a lot of differences on this issue. You saw recently the finance secretary who was transferred to be the power secretary, he has opted for voluntary retirement. He is the man who pushed this sovereign bond matter. So there is already problems they are facing regarding this. Many economists who are official economists, not people who oppose their policies, are saying this is a very bad idea. But I hope that there will be rethinking on this matter within the government. I mentioned it, I don't know whether you saw it. I said that is the Supreme Court gave a judgment which is a totally bogus judgment, because the FRA, Foreign Forest Rights Act, does not provide, there's no provision for evictions. So that bench which gave it was totally wrong. But more dangerous now, which I don't know whether you're aware, in the budget, but just after the budget, they have brought amendments to the Forest Act, that is the Indian Forest Act, that amendments are going to nullify whatever rights or provisions were there in the Forest Rights Act. I mentioned that. That is going to be the more dangerous thing now. What the Supreme Court did, let me explain. They are now going to, they are legalizing it by saying that the Forest Department will be given the powers to declare that the Adivasis living here, they have no right over the land, nullifying what was the earlier provisions in the Forest Rights Act. So that attack is coming also. Supreme Court thing is going on. Now the hearing has started again. All the state governments were asked to give affidavits. Our government of Kerala has made the case that it was unconstitutional for you to give such a judgment. That fight will go on. But beyond that, now they are bringing the Forest Rights Act amendment, which will nullify the Forest Rights Act itself. That is our immediate worry also. That has to be also faced.
The acts that presently, which are as bills that has been passing in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha in 2019 after the 17th Lok Sabha had started, like UAPA Act, RTI Act, they're not still acts but bills which are being passed, and with no opposition which can stop BJP from passing them, you see rights of citizens which are being held back. So how do you think, I mean, how do you think we as youth can, you know, do something in order to stop things like that?
Yeah. See, all these legislations you have mentioned, whether it's the RTI Act, whether the UAPA Act, all the other acts which you have, legislation you have mentioned, in Parliament, there is opposition to it, but as you know, in the Lok Sabha, they have a big majority.
Yeah.
And in the Raj Sabha, the reason why they are organizing these defections, they are only four short of a majority now.
Exactly.
You see? And they hope to get that. Or they are trying to pressurize these parties like the YSRCP and the TRS to support them. So that is how they are getting it through. So the fight will have to be outside Parliament. You see, after all, eventually, laws may be made, unjust laws may be made, but who will fight it? Only when the people oppose it and fight it can then the opportunity come for you to change those laws. So you'll have to fight those laws. I mentioned UAPA, the draconian provisions. Now, when outside Parliament, you have to organize the widest resistance and opposition. And that is the job we have to do today. We can't depend on Parliament to stop this today because of the change in the balance of forces within Parliament. But you're right, we have to take up all these issues and fight. And more such legislations are coming in the coming days.
Sir, also one more thing on the financial background, like taking the SEBI's where they're taking off 75% of the SEBI's reserves and also RBI's reserves are being taken away. And also the sovereign bonds, which sir has mentioned earlier. So the whole financial background of the country is being changed, also with 70,000 recapitalization sending back to the state banks. So there is we don't see a path where you see secular or a democratic building has been coming up.
You see, that is what is the whole meaning of authoritarianism. Authoritarianism means you ride roughshod over all norms and established regulations. You make your own according to your requirement. So whether it's RBI reserves being taken over or SEBI, as you said, their reserves, everything is now open field for them. They try to appropriate anything because they have a parliamentary majority. And unfortunately, they have got a parliamentary majority through the democratic electoral process. So you have authoritarianism, which legitimizes itself saying, we have got the mandate to do this. So the only way this mandate can be undone or these laws be reversed is when we build up sufficient popular support and pressure against these policies, which will finally reflect itself. But it's a long fight. It's not, there's no shortcut to it, you see. In every attack, whether it's in the finance sector, whether it's in the
political sector,
economic policies, whether the social sector, in everything we have to resist and fight. Unfortunately, a section of the opposition is so demoralized today, they say nothing can be done now. You see, and they are vulnerable, as I explained. Many of them are got their own interests, business interests, other interests, they want to protect it. But we don't have that. My party doesn't have such vulnerabilities. I can give you a small example. They are trying to get majority in the Raj Sabha by hook or by crook. Last week, one of our Raj Sabha MPs, she's a lady called Jharna Das. She comes from Tripura. She sought an appointment with the Home Minister, Amit Shah, in Parliament. Got the appointment to go to him to say in Tripura, they are rigging this election, panchayat, there's law and order, serious problem, they're attacking the opposition, you have to give something. She presented a memorandum. He read it and said, oh, you're from the CPM. CPM is finished. Please come and join our party. Home Minister sitting there. But the difference between Jharna Das and your TDP MPs is what? She said, I come to see the Home Minister, not the BJP president. Second, she said, one CPM member remains, we will fight you. And when she started shouting, the other BJP MPs who were there went and tried to pacify her. She was shouting at Amit Shah, how dare you do this to me? You see? That's the difference. Her background is what? Her husband was a martyr, killed some years ago. You see, he died because he was fighting for her party. So she's not made of this sort of stuff, who will be bought over by Amit Shah or somebody. So you have to fight. We have to resist all these pressures and build widest popular mobilization. Let us hope we can do it. Yeah.